customary that we take 30 minutes of public comment. And I have a few slips here, and I'm going to begin with Brian Sullivan.
Can you hear me? Brian Sullivan, president of the Nassau County Correctional Officers Benevolent Association. Good afternoon, everybody. Just to touch base on everything that's happened here before, I also want to express my sincerest condolences to everybody in the legislature and Judy Jacobs' family, Ann's family from the old administration. I worked very closely with Judy and Ann for several years in my prior incarnation in the union, and they're definitely going to be missed. I've had several long days and nights going over things with Judy, and I can definitely say that Judy was one of the good ones, and she was always nonpartisan politically, but very partisan towards doing the right thing for people that needed it. And she's going to be sorely missed, particularly in government. Two quick issues that I just want to touch base with you guys here today. One is, I know there's a bunch of bonding issues that are coming up before the legislature today. I'm hoping that there will be some nonpartisan joining together, because there's a lot of what's buried in some of that bonding are things that are going to be going on at the jail. One is pushing to get a locker room done for my guys. There's a lot of general upkeep in the jail that's buried in DPW things in there, and I'm hoping that since I'm always up here and talking to you guys in the county about keeping up on the infrastructure, I'm hoping that we can get some of that done, because there's a lot more coming down the road. The other main issue that I'm here is, I don't know if anybody here, you saw us in the press the other day. We were in the paper, we were on TV, about one of our correction officers was knocked unconscious in the visiting room. And that happened a couple of weeks ago, and the inmate that did it was being held in our jail on a $500,000 bond for attempted murder, gun charges, storing explosives, endangering the welfare of a child. This is the type of inmate that we keep at this jail. A lot of people try to pretend they don't know what's going on in the jail. I'm not saying you guys, but they try to downplay the type of people that we have at the jail, and obviously it's not a drunk tank. We're holding some heavy-duty inmates here. This particular guy was creating a disturbance in the visiting room and was told to end his visit and go back to his cell, and when he stood up, he punched one of my officers. They got into a bit of a fracas and ultimately ended up knocking one of my officers unconscious, who had to be taken out in an ambulance. That's the second time in the last year that one of our officers was knocked unconscious by an inmate. Both of them had to be taken out by ambulance. This and the other one were both in fully staffed areas of the jail, which illustrates to me and should illustrate to everybody concerned in here and in the jail and in the county government, that if this can happen in a fully staffed area of the jail, imagine our concerns of what's going on in the areas that have been cut. I've talked endlessly, and I know my predecessor and when I was here before, we've talked endlessly about cuts that go on in this jail and what are we doing about enhancing cuts at the jail. I had enhancing security at the jail, forgive me, I've got a cold. I also sat down with several of you prior to meeting today, because there are security issues at the jail that I can't discuss in public. Things that I will not discuss in public, things about what's going on with the debate tonight, what's going on at the jail. I can only ask those of you in the legislature, particularly in the Public Safety Committee, to press the sheriff about what is he doing to enhance security at the jail. I see constantly enhancements for the police department, purchases of equipment, vehicles, equipment, trucks, whatever else, emergency response. I don't see any of that coming from our sheriff, and it's particularly going into budget season. I want to see exactly what the sheriff is planning on doing to enhance security at the jail. Thankfully, we haven't had any horrific incidents involving one of my officers. We've had several things in the past where you've seen in the paper there's been slashings of inmates, but thank God, our officers are only getting knocked unconscious by inmates, which is a pretty awful thing to say. There are several issues that are outstanding that I'm pressing the sheriff and the county on about enhancements for our emergency response team, for equipment that are still supposedly out there that's going to be coming any day now. It's becoming any day now for 9 months. Metal detection, contraband detection equipment, and sometimes I think I'm going to knock myself unconscious banging my head against the wall. The order of the day seems to be how low can we run this jail on before the thing completely bottoms out. all I can ask is, particularly going into the budget season, please keep this in mind. I would ask, I'll be here for the budget committee meetings when the sheriff is here. I would ask that you also keep that in mind and ask him what we're going to be doing going forward to enhance security in this jail. That's all I have for today. I appreciate the time. Again, Judy Jacobs is in my mind. She's been a very good friend to correction officers, and she'll be sorely missed. Anybody have anything for me? Have a nice day. Get home tonight.
Thank you. Joseph Stefano.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Joe Stefano. Do you need a name and address, or good? Does everybody know who I am? My agenda is not changed since I ran for legislature against Mr. Kennedy and ran for town of Oyster Bay. My agenda is on goodethics.com. If anybody's got a laptop or a smartphone, they can go to goodethics.com. My agenda is listed there by 1, 2, and 3. The first is, and the only thing, is the new police officers. I applaud everybody's efforts. What we're doing with Nassau County Police Department is great. We have a commissioner. We have new police officers. But there is one thing that we can do better, and that is we're only training the police officers once a year. Okay? I don't know about you, but I think the incidents which I'm talking about in Tulsa, Oklahoma, what happened in Hofstra, what happened in Massapequa, with the accidental shootings of the police officers by other police officers. Okay? The law of averages is in our favor if we increase the frequency of training from once a year to 4 times a year. Now, next question is, great idea, Joe. How are you gonna do it? How are you gonna pay for it? Well, here's $500,000 sitting there on item 2. Nassau County Medical Center has a bid that was supposed to be closed on March 1st, which would save you $500,000 a year. Right now, they're skirting the bid procedure by paying month to month, okay? If you enforce that bid, you'll save $500,000, which is $480,000 is what you need to train those police officers 4 times a year. So there's your money. Okay, the answer is train those police officers. You're gonna have a new 21-year-old police officer out there only with a handgun for the first time with a week's training. Do you feel comfortable him taking a shot next to you or your child? I just want you to think that about that, okay? So item number 1 and item number 2 has been covered. The Glen Gariff Medical Center in Glen Cove. Its least path resistance to the hospital is a road called Acres Way, which ambulances have been towed twice. So you can't get from the Glen Gariff Medical Center to the hospital without towing the ambulance. That was the third way. My agenda here today was for saving lives, and all three are for saving lives. The first one is for the misfiring of firearms by Nassau County police officers. I'm not saying anything's wrong, I'm just saying they're undertrained. As an ex-military person, we were only allowed one bullet per perpetrator, okay? A second bullet shot meant automatic court martial. I'm not saying we're gonna get standards like that, but it would be nice to have Nassau County to be the Navy SEALs of police officers. We live in Nassau County, we deserve it. We deserve the best. So if you consider upping their training for firearms. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stefano. Pat Boyle.
Hello, everyone.
Hi, Pat.
My name is Pat Boyle from Gateway Youth Outreach in Elmont, and I'm also representing Coalition of Youth Service Agencies. I know this is a very difficult day for all of you with the passing of Legislator Jacobs. It's also a very difficult day for youth services as well, too. She was a champion for youth services. She was the, as a matter of fact, as you well know, in Elmont, it was a basically very Republican area 21 years ago. I knew the Republican legislators, but it was Judy Jacobs who invited me into her office to talk to her about youth services, not caring whether I was coming from a Republican area or not. And we got a real good opportunity to be able to get to know each other over the years. And I know youth services is going to be missing her sorely. There's no doubt about that. Legislator Abrahams, I would be very remiss if I didn't acknowledge how well you represented both the legislature and yourself at her service. You did a great job. You told a great story. You made me really feel like I really knew who she was, even more so than what I did. It was a great job, and I'm really glad that you were able to do that.
Thank you.
On to business, as she would say, I'm sure. The county executive, Mangano, has placed in his budget youth services at the same levels as what it was at last year. That is a very good thing, obviously. But the thing that kind of worries me a little bit about all of that is there's a lot more going on besides the budget that just came out and what's in front of you right now. Youth services, as you well know, has always been discretionary. The fact that it's discretionary means that it's sometimes at the bottom of the lower rung of the ladder as far as finances go. But I hope that you understand clearly that it's not at the bottom rung of the ladder as far as services that are provided to people within this county. Youth services are important. We just, again, I know I sound like I'm repeating myself over and over again, but it's a good thing that I am, because we just registered 800 kids once again for after-school programs in Elmont, in four schools in Elmont. That's 800 kids who won't be on the street between the hours of 3 and 6. I know I sound like I'm repeating myself, but there are some new legislators here who do need to hear this. 3 to 6 is the time when most crime is committed by young people. You would think it's Friday and Saturday night? No. It's when their parents aren't there, and that's when we are there. On top of that, we're hiring 120 high school and college age students to work with these children. That's another thing that's keeping 120 students not only off the street during that period of 3 to 6, but we're also paying them a salary. And we all know what minimum wage is now, and we haven't gotten any increases in funding. I don't know how I'm gonna do this, but I'll figure it out. But now that the minimum wage has gone up quite a bit, it's becoming quite a bit of a strain. But the kids are making some pretty good money for a high school or college age student. They work at least 15 hours with us a week, so they're popping down 150 bucks a week. That's not bad. It really isn't. And we want to be able to keep doing these kind of programs. Please, I implore you once again to take a close look at what we do, how we do it, and how cheap it really is in the long run. Please don't cut out the youth services. Please make sure that you can do what you can to keep us whole. Thank you.
You're welcome, Pat. Alec Slatsky?
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for having me here. And I first just want to express my condolences to all of you, and of course to Legislator Jacobs' family and friends. I interacted with her once or twice, and that limited interaction was very pleasant, and clearly to my detriment that I didn't get to meet her more. So I do want to extend my condolences to all of you. My name is Alex Slatsky. I'm here representing AAA. And I wanted to talk just a little bit about the $105 proposed public safety fee on traffic and parking red light camera tickets that came out in the recent budget. And when I saw that, I said, I definitely have to get in front of the legislature at the next meeting to talk about it. And just to give a little background, AAA, we're nonpartisan. We don't endorse anyone. We don't give anyone any money for a campaign. It's totally nonpartisan here. And we do think it's okay to make money off of traffic fines. But there's a difference between making money off of traffic fines and trying to make money off of traffic fines. And I think we're moving too far to the latter here. We strongly oppose the fee. And the reason why it's bad primarily is that it erodes a traffic safety culture that we really need to have in Nassau County. I mean, we lost 92 people on our roads last year in 2015. That's the same as the amount of murders between 2012 and 2015. So we need the police to protect us from murders, from other crime, for a whole variety of services, and also from traffic crashes, which are very dangerous here. But when it looks like the government is instituting a fine solely to raise revenue, then when people get a ticket, they don't think, oh, I need to stop speeding, I need to do better. They think, this is baloney, the government is just trying to reach into my pocket to take my money so they can keep themselves whole. And that's a problem. We really need to move the traffic safety culture up. And instead, I think this is bringing it down even more than what it is. And it really is a conflict of interest, even if it's not going to materialize in any real way. It's clearly a perception problem that the police are giving tickets to fund the police. There's something a little bit backwards there. And it relies on bad behavior to fund the county. I mean, under this plan, it would be a problem if fewer people broke the law. I don't think that those are good incentives. And I do think, frankly, the county makes enough money off of traffic fines. I mean, the county TPVA website says that they have, you know, administrative fees so that county taxpayers don't shoulder the burden of...
Sir, 3 minutes has expired.
Okay. Just to
wrap it up with Mr. Slatsky.
Sure. Yeah, so, I mean, I just don't think that with all the police that need to be here, that they need to do, there's a lot they need to do. I don't think that means we must have a $220 fine for an expired meter. I think there's a leap in logic there. And I would be happy to discuss with all of you, all of the legislators further at a later date. So thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming.
Well, I have a question.
I'd like to move on.
Just a quick question.
Mr. Slatsky, Legislator Sylogis has a question.
Sure. Thank you very much for coming here today. this safety fee being contemplated in the budget, the upcoming budget, have you seen this used in other jurisdictions, and what effect has it had?
I haven't really seen anything like this. I mean, we've seen administrative fees. Like, administrative fees aren't new. The county has them, Suffolk County has them, other counties in the state have them. But I think this level of increase is not something that I've personally seen elsewhere. It's a pretty big jump. I mean, doubling fines in some cases. And, you know, I don't really have a good parallel, to be frank. This is definitely unique, at least here in New York State, which is the territory that I'm most familiar with. This level of jump is unique.
And so I want to know, Mr. Slatsky, we have our budget hearings coming up next month. The first is October 5th. The second is October 13th. Hopefully, you'll be able to come to either one of those and express your point of view. And of course, at the end of the month, we vote on the budget.
Yep.
Between now and then, many things change.
Okay,
so thank you for coming. Good afternoon, members of the legislature. It's my honor to speak with you today. I was going to speak with you about the Baldwin Road diet plan, which I will. I'll keep my comments to under 3 minutes, but I would like to comment about what the gentleman just said. I've addressed the legislature in the past about red light camera issues. Many of the new legislators may not know my addressing you in the past, but some of you veterans will remember that I advocated a fair timing of the yellow light duration of red light cameras, and I'm also advocating a countdown timer being placed at whatever intersection red light camera is placed at, so it's not entrapment of a driver that would normally be going at an appropriate speed through an intersection, and traffic approaching the intersection, drivers would have an opportunity to in advance see if the countdown timer was 3, 2, 1, they could start braking in advance. Please consider mandating that any intersection that has a red light camera also has a countdown timer placed at that intersection. I'll get back to what I was originally going to address you about, and I would like to first of all mention I really appreciate the fact that we have guys like firefighter Fred as a Baldwin resident. Him being Firefighter of the Year is a wonderful thing. I would like to also mention to you that our main fire department is located right at the area where this Baldwin Grand Avenue road diet is proposed. Grand Avenue right now is two lanes in each direction, north and south. The proposal is to change it to one lane north, one lane south, and a turn lane in between. I feel that it's going to impede not only the firefighter response time, but first precinct response time, availability of getting to our closest hospital, Nassau Community Hospital, and also getting the fact that there's a brand new equation that has to be considered. This past week, the town of Hempstead town council voted for a proposal to construct a project at the intersection of Grand Avenue and Merrick Road that will include residents, 50 family residences at that location. I want to point out to you that the traffic study, Nassau County's official traffic study, the Complete Streets Traffic Study, says that the Grand Avenue at that location has 19,488 ADT, average daily traffic vehicles. I also want to also point out that the official U.S. Department of Transportation Federal Highway Administration guidelines, Chapter 3, Section 3, Subsection 5, suggests that roadways with ADT of 20,000 or more are not good candidates for the road diet.
Sir, your 3 minutes have expired.
I'll wrap it up by saying that that intersection is the only two-lane northbound hurricane evacuation route anywhere between Rockville Center and Freeport. I ask you not to waste $7 million on changing a recently repaved roadway that's in perfectly good condition to a roadway that's going to be a problem and would likely have to be reconstructed afterwards. I'd further like to ask if we could have a referendum on this where Baldwin residents could vote on it before action is taken. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. McClure. Karen Montalbano? Karen?
Hi, my name is Karen Montalbano. I'm the president of the Baldwin Civic Association. I'm here once again in support of that next round of funding for the engineering phase of the Grand Avenue traffic study. Now, this traffic study has taken an in-depth look at our main roadway in Baldwin and empirically has determined that what many residents know, Grand Avenue in its current state is not working at its best for the community. The study highlighted areas for improvement. One of them is the failing intersection in the north, outside the senior citizen complex and the high school, which our young people travel through every day of the school year. And I was told there was a big accident there just yesterday. We also have to deal with the traffic blockages at Seaman Avenue and St. Luke's Place, where left turn lanes are needed to help traffic move smoothly through. We want to make the whole length of the street safer for those who walk or ride bicycles. And then there's the placemaking aspects of making the street welcoming for businesses and shoppers. That includes the traffic calming and the road diet, which some people are opposing. And I would like to note that there are many others who do support this idea. This road diet has worked in many other communities, and it actually ties into the transit-oriented development that is being proposed at Grand and Merrick in the Town of Hempstead project. After all this data gathering and evaluation, it would be a waste to not continue on to the engineering phase of this project. The only way to truly have any idea of what this will look like and how it will work is to see a fully engineered plan. The traffic engineers who will make this concept a reality have the expertise. They have spent years studying to get their degrees, studying to get their license, and then have additional years actually doing the designs and even more time keeping up with best practices. They are not doing this based on gut. We need to address traffic problems on Grand Avenue in a holistic way and look at all the possibilities. We're on the verge of making a breakthrough and getting through the traffic on Grand Avenue. We need this next phase to move forward. Please vote to fund this. We need it for this next step. Baldwin needs to move into the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Montalbano. Thank you. All right, thank you. Legislator Curran.
Thank you. So we all thought the hot debate was happening at Hofstra tonight, but it's happening right here. I actually attended the town meeting where the town of Hempstead approved picking the developers for the downtown project, and I was very happy that they approved it unanimously, and I spoke in support of it there. I think that this downtown project in the town of Hempstead dovetails beautifully with what we're doing with the Grand Avenue traffic study. I think they really complement each other, these two projects. And I just wanted to put that on the record. Thank you.
Thank you, Legislator Curran. Okay, that ends our public comment. We can now proceed to the calendar. And I'm going to begin with several appointments, beginning with items 70 through 76. I will call each of them separately, but then I'm going to ask for a vote on each of the individuals. Some of them are not calling primarily because they could not be here today. All right, so that will be item, I believe, 72.
That's correct, Madam Chair.
Correct.
72, the only person missing for the appointment to the Soil and Water Conservation District is Eric Swenson. Everybody else is here, Madam Chair.
Okay, that sounds good. All right. So we're going to begin with item 70, a resolution to confirm the appointment of Daniel C. Fusey. Item 71, a resolution to confirm the appointment of Reese Michaels to the Soil and Water Conservation District.
Madam Chair, I thought you were going to start with 70, which is Dan Fucci.
Well, I was going to block them all together, and then we'll have a chance to vote on each of them. I'm calling them all together.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Then you can talk. All right. 72, we said we're not calling because the individual could not be here. 73, resolution to confirm the appointment of Tara Snyder Moran to the Soil and Water Conservation District. Hopefully you're all getting up there. So you can say whatever you need to say. So, resolution 74, the reappointment of Jamie Van Dyke to the Soil and Water Conservation District. 75, a reappointment of Patricia Aiken to the Soil and Water Conservation District. And 76, the reappointment of Kevin Braun to the Soil and Water Conservation District. Motion is resolved. Moved by Legislator Dunn, seconded by Legislator Nicolau. And now, you may, if they wish to express themselves, they can be certainly, well, Mr. Fusey, I think you were there first, so maybe you should say how long you've been waiting to be appointed to this body.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, members of the Nassau County Legislature. My name is Dan Fucci, and I would be the representing Nassau County on the Soil and Water Conservation District Board. Thank you.
Okay, all right. And we have Reese Michaels. Where are you? I've seen you before. Go ahead.
Yes, you've seen me before at Cornell's Cooperative.
Right, that's absolutely. I know the face.
So hello.
Say who you are. And why are you so thrilled to be appointed?
No, my name is Reese Michaels, and I'm delighted to be here, and I'm delighted for the opportunity to speak to you as well as to be on the committee. I've learned an awful lot in the last few years since I've retired about both soil and water. Both are very neglected resources, and we neglect them every single day to our detriment. So I'm hoping that since I've joined this committee and I see how active they are and how involved they are, it's good to be part of it. So thank you very much.
You're most welcome. Tara. Hi, Tara Snyder Moran.
Hi, Tara Snyder Moran. I'm with the Town of Hempstead Department of Conservation and Waterways, and I'll be representing the Town of Hempstead. Very excited to participate with the district as a new board member.
Jamie Van Dyke. Okay, Jamie's been on this before.
Yes, I'm Jamie Van Dyke. I work for the town of Oyster Bay. I currently am the chair of the board of the Conservation District since 2013. I know many of you personally have gotten to know you over the years from being on the executive council to the Alumni Association at Hofstra University and many other civic activities around the North Shore. I'd like to take a few minutes of your time to discuss the vital role that Nassau County Soil and Water Conservation District plays in the county. It It's been in operation since 1977, and next year we'll be going into our 40th year. In Nassau, our Soil and Water Conservation District motto truly sums up what we work on and what we do, and that is working together for healthy water and clean soil. I've also submitted to the clerk a brief 7-page PowerPoint presentation that I'm going through right now. In 1933, severe erosion problems from the Dust Bowl caused the federal government to establish the Soil Erosion Service within the U.S. Department of the Interior. After large-scale projects proved too slow and cumbersome, individual state legislatures passed laws to form soil and water conservation districts. In New York, in the 1940s, the New York legislature moved forward that each county could produce their own soil and water conservation district. And hence, here we are since 1977 in Nassau. Soil and water conservation districts are local units of government that manage and direct natural resource programs at the local level. Districts work both in urban and rural settings with landowners and with units of government to carry out a program for the conservation, use, and development of soil, water, and related natural resources. One crucial niche that the district performs for Nassau County and the municipalities that are represented on this board is that we can do work, the district can do work on private land and help out your constituents where maybe the county or the townships can't. There are 58 soil and water conservation districts throughout the state, one per county and one for all the 5 boroughs of New York City. There are 4 cornerstones of soil and water conservation districts. They are natural resource management, which includes farm planning, which is the backbone of many rural soil and water conservation districts in New York, whereas down here we do a lot more with shoreline protection, invasive species management, and also promoting native species and restoration projects. Another cornerstone is project implementation, which includes securing grants and administering them, and helping out municipalities with various natural resource projects that they might have. That can also include looking at the design and best management practices on a project, and again, that can take place both on public and private lands. Public involvement is another cornerstone, and that includes networking, building consensus for natural resources throughout the county, public participation in a wide range of environmental issues, and also environmental education. Another key cornerstone is land use planning, and that's where the conservation districts can help with soil interpretations, open space planning, farmland protection, water quality monitoring, and something that Nassau County has not gotten taken advantage of yet is that about 4 years ago, the governor actually made it so that conservation easements, that conservation districts can hold them. Nassau County Soil and Water Conservation District is uniquely qualified to work across boundaries for environmental protection. It has a wide network of many partners, associations, and organizations that it calls upon and works with daily. In particular, a 4-year agreement with the United States Department of Agriculture through its Natural Resource Conservation Service allows municipalities and the district to tap into for free or at cost specialized equipment and science that municipalities don't employ on their own. We also continually work on expanding the district's partnerships. Some current efforts of the Nassau County Soil and Water Conservation District that I'd like to highlight is that the district is constantly acting as an incubator to address new and routine natural resource concerns in the county. Public outreach and education coupled with boots on the ground action provide the manpower and technical assistance on many different programs taking place throughout the county. Just this year alone, over 5 schools were met with, plus for the 10th year, conservation district staff presented at the Ecology Fair at Oceanside Schools, as well as Nassau BOCES Conservation Education Day for elementary schools. I also implore you all to save the date for the 19th annual Long Island Regional Envirothon, which will be taking place on April 25th next year at Old Bethpage Village Restoration. The Long Island Regional Envirothon is another key component of what we work on. It's probably one of the top 7 programs that the Conservation District works on. It's an annual studies program for Nassau County and Suffolk County high school students. And there are 38 schools that routinely compete through tests and oral competition to address matters such as water quality, soils, forestry, and natural resource conservation. Also this year, the Conservation District, for several years we've been working with Hewlett Schools on a tree grow-out station, and some of the trees that have grown and matured to about 3 to 4 feet in height have actually been transplanted into Nassau County's Grant Park. The Conservation District is also slowly working to try and secure more school districts around the county to follow Hewlett's lead. And this year we're actually going to be working with an elementary school in Hicksville to do the same. For the county, and actually this helps the county with its federal and state mandated stormwater reporting, which now takes, is going to take place twice a year. The Conservation District actually provides education and outreach for Nassau County. It helps check off a box on a number of things that the county is supposed to be doing. This year we have attended, the staff and some of the directors have attended over 10 fairs and festivals throughout the county. Also, green infrastructure is a term that is a real buzzword within municipalities to deal with tightening federal and state stormwater regulations. The Stormwater Conservation District staff, along with its board, as well as partnering with Suffolk County Soil and Water Conservation District and New York City Soil and Water Conservation District, held 3 very successful green infrastructure conferences where we have educated municipalities and the public, as well as contractors, on things such as rain gardens, bioswales, rain barrels, and many other things that they can do, that public and private landowners can do to retrofit their properties to help filter and clean water, clean storm water before it goes into our open waterways. From that effort, thousands of people have been educated, and we're starting to see rain gardens and rain barrels pop up everywhere. Rain barrels can be readily sold. You can see them at Home Depot, many garden centers, and also rain gardens. Nassau Community College has one now, Long Island University Post Campus. The town of Oyster Bay has about 5 of them. I'm working on one with the Conservation District this fall. The Conservation District also received a grant, about $40,000, from the Long Island Sound Futures Fund, and it's now going to be building 3 rain gardens, one of them at Nassau County's Cedar Mere Preserve, which hopefully most of you know is the home, former home of William Cullen Bryant, one of the most famous residents on from Long Island. We're also going to be building one at Babel's Village Hall and at the entrance to the Center Island near the police booth. Some quick restoration projects that we worked on recently have included invasive species poles at several ponds in Massapequa. We routinely do trail maintenance over at, we're starting to routinely do trail maintenance over at Muttontown Preserve. We have a rain garden there. We are housed on your property over there. And we are looking to advise more on invasive species management at that property and be good stewards of where we're housed. The Bar Beach restoration with the town of North Hempstead, the Mill Pond over in Port Washington, there's been some restoration efforts there. Scudder's Pond, there's been Phragmites removal for 2 years in a row over in Sea Cliff. And many of you know by now, I'm sure, about LICAP and LINAP, the Long Island Commission on Aquifer Protection, and the Long Island Nitrogen Action Plan. The Soil and Water Conservation District has roles with both of those. We also continually support native species programming and helped found the Long Island Native Plant Initiative so that homeowners can go and secure native plants to put into their gardens, as well as for restoration projects on municipalities. And one other thing I'd really like to highlight is something currently that we do is that we provide a DEC-mandated stormwater management class that annually trains hundreds of contractors throughout the region on best management practices to deal with stormwater. I mentioned some of the projects that I mentioned already entailed some grants, and Soil and Water Conservation Districts, if you're looking to include, to kind of increase your chances of getting funding at the federal and state level, it definitely looks good to partner with the Soil and Water Conservation District. So in summation, please note that the Soil and Water Conservation District is here for you. And it's more than money that keeps the county going. It's a good quality of life, and the people here are engaged in our great beaches and our great open space that we have. The Saltwater Conservation District, that's essential to everything that we work on, and we're continually looking for ways to help not only Nassau County, but all the municipalities around the county to secure funding and perform outreach and boots-on-the-ground efforts to help protect our natural resources. Please consider including the Conservation District in your future legislative mailings, and note that if you have problems with constituents that may have some fungus or problem on their property or flooding, that the Soil and Water Conservation District is here for you. I request that each of you please take a look at the newly updated Nassau County Soil and Water Conservation District website, which is on the cover of the packet that was sent around to you. And hopefully you'll join the effort in working together for healthy soil and clean water. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jane. And Legislative Ward, I have to ask you a question.
Okay.
What is the term for each of you? How many years do you serve until you're reappointed?
Well, I have the district law in front of me.
I know, I'm just curious because some of you are reappointed.
Some are 1 year, some are 2 year.
It staggers.
So
that's an answer.
Yeah.
One and two years.
Go. Who's going to talk?
Okay, who's next? Who do you have? That was Jamie, right?
Yeah.
We got Patricia
Atkin. Yes, Patricia Atkin.
Hi, thank you. Hold on, Patricia.
Thank you.
Some of you may be familiar with me. I think the last time I had the privilege of addressing the legislature, I was actually here being honored for my work on behalf of the environment. I was nominated by Judy Jacobs, and I share your grief at her loss. She was a truly wonderful woman, and I'm very, very sorry that she's gone. In any event, I am nominated to be an at-large member. You also may remember me. I'm the former executive director of Friends of the Bay in Oyster Bay. I did a lot of work on marine advocacy. I am continuing in my work both with the Soil and Water Conservation District. I'm also the chairman of the ward of the Whalen Museum and Education Center at Cold Spring Harbor. And I'm a member of the newly forming Theodore Roosevelt Conservation Legacy Partnership. So there's a certain amount of initiatives that I'm continuing to do to work on behalf of Nassau County and Long Island's environment. Thank you.
And Kevin.
Thank you, Patricia. Kevin Braun.
Hi, I'm Kevin Braun. I'm the town of North Hempstead's appointee, and I'm an environmental specialist for the town.
That's it, Madam Chair.
Ask a question.
Okay.
I guess, Jamie, it might be you that I, as you gave that wonderful presentation. My question, I'm looking at your website. When do you hold meetings?
Usually the third Friday of the month at 9 a.m. We encourage you to attend.
Okay, and it would be in the office that's here, like listed?
It's at Nassau Hall, which is on the south side of Muttontown Preserve at 1864 Muttontown Road.
Your address is on here, mm-hmm. Right? That's exactly. So third Friday of every month?
Yes.
And do you also, like, I know since you have partnerships with the various state levels or county level or town levels, all these different levels of government, do you make recommendations or can you require certain, like, you know, for them to adhere, like maybe, I don't know if you can make laws or...
No, we can't make laws, we can't require anything, but if there's something that you'd like some technical advice upon, we can help with that.
Okay, I'm going to be contacting you. Thank you.
Legislator DiRiggio.
Hi, good to see all of you. I know you mentioned that you meet with ICAP and the Water Reassurance, I guess, Board. Do you know, how often do you guys meet with them?
LICAP, there is a subcommittee that our district manager attends those meetings, and I think that takes place quarterly. LINAP is still forming, the Long Island Nitrogen Action Plan, but Carrie Mee Gallagher with DEC Region 1 and several other people on that who are putting that plan together have actually put into the plan that the Conservation District be advised on a few projects.
Okay, I've been approached recently that some of these boards are not meeting frequently enough. I don't know if you're ever...
We're extremely active.
No, not you. I'm saying with some of the county ones that we... No, I didn't mean to apply you. I'm saying these. So if you don't know, maybe you can keep us updated also on what you think, especially with the nitrogen board.
Sure.
All right, thank you.
Legislative Jersey Witten said it. Okay, I'm quite impressed, Jamie. Well, job well done. Okay, oh, I'm sorry. Legislative Walker, see how impressed?
Yes, I was very impressed with the presentation, and I've had the opportunity and pleasure of often working with Jamie. We used to work together, but since I've been over here, she's still at the town. Anytime I have a question, you're always there to answer those questions for me. And to each and every one of you, and to the new appointees, I know how hard you're going to continue to work, you know, on this very, very important issue. And I, too, look forward to attending those meetings. They're held on a good day for me, so that's great. Jamie, I just had a quick question. I know you said one of the Hicksville Elementary Schools will be involved in the tree program. Could you tell me which school it is?
Sure. For about 8 years now, 7 or 8 years now, the Soil and Water Conservation District's been advising on an outdoor classroom that takes place at Old Country Road Elementary School. And Sue Simon is the advisor for that project, and the Tria Grow Out Station, that'll be taking place this year. She's also been inquiring about putting a rain garden in the future.
Excellent, excellent. So that's right around the corner from my house, so nice to be aware of that. I actually wasn't aware that that program was taking place in that school, so thank you.
There being no other comments or questions, all those in favor of item 70 resolution, 72, I'm sorry, 71, 73, 74, 75, and 76. Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Guess what? You are duly appointed and reappointed unanimously. All right.
Madam Chair, John Butnick was standing with the appointees in solidarity with them
in
approval and support of their efforts here in Nassau County. So I just want to let you know that.
And it seems to me, from what I heard, that Gaskell is a person you're certainly going to get a good job because they never say no. So, all right, now we have what is called a consent calendar, and I'm going to read those items. That means that both the majority.
Madam Chair, I'm sorry. I just wanted to thank you for calling the appointees first before the rest of the business of the legislature, so they can get back to work. Thank you again.
Okay, you're welcome. Okay, we have several items that are part of the consent calendar, which means that both minority and majority have agreed on these items. So I'm going to begin with item one, which is ordinance 103. Deal with me because I have to turn pages here now. I know, try to talk to me. All right, the next item is item 40, ordinance 142. Item 41, ordinance 143. Item 42, ordinance 144. Item 43, ordinance 145. Item 44, ordinance 146. Item 45, ordinance 147. Item 46, ordinance 148. Item 47, ordinance 149. Item 48, ordinance 150. Item 49, ordinance 151. Item 50, ordinance 152. Item 51, ordinance 153. Item 52, ordinance 154. Item 53, ordinance 155. Item 54, ordinance 156. Item 55, ordinance 157. Item 56, ordinance 158. Item 57, resolution 141. Item 58, resolution 142. Item 59, resolution 143, Item 61, Resolution 145. Item 62, Item 62, Resolution 146. Item 63, Resolution 147. Item 64, Resolution 148. Item 65, Resolution 149. Item 66, Resolution 150. Item 67, Resolution 151. Item 68, Resolution 152. And I can call the appointments. And I believe it's item 77, Resolution 161. Item 79, Resolution 163. Item 81, Resolution 165. Item 82, Resolution 166. Item 83, Resolution 167. And item 84, Resolution 168. Item 85, Resolution 169. And item 86, Resolution 170. That's the end of the consent calendar. Motion, please. Moved by Legislator Dunn, seconded by Legislator Walker. Any questions, any comments? There being none, all those in favor of the items just called, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, the items pass unanimously. Okay. I'd like to proceed to item 87 and 88. I'm going to ask the clerk to call item 87, which is Resolution 134. Go ahead, Ms. Bolton.
Thank you. A resolution to authorize the county assessor and or the county treasurer and or the receiver of taxes of the town of North Hempstead to correct erroneous assessments and taxes in accordance with petitions of the county assessor on specific properties situated in various school districts assessed to specific schools and or county years pursuant to this resolution, pursuant to the real property tax law, the county government law of Nassau County, and the Nassau County Administrative Code 276-16.
So moved. Moved by Legislator Dunn, seconded by Legislator Nicolau. And now I'm going to ask for an amendment to the nature of a substitution, please. There is an amendment to this item, which is, and I will read it into the record, this amendment changes the resolution by correcting the title and language in the resolved clause from Town of North Hempstead to the Town of Oyster Bay. This amendment also adds petition number 53-2016 to the resolution, as well as adds to the petition itself to the backup materials to the resolution. Motion, please, to suspend the rule. To amend the rule, I'm sorry. Motion by Legislator Dunn, seconded by Legislator Moore. All right, any discussion? A motion on the amendment, please. All those in favor of the amendment signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, the amendment passes. Now for the item as amended. Any questions, comments regarding this item? Any public comment on this item? There being none, all those in favor of item 87, Resolution 134, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The item passes, I believe, unanimously. 88, I'll just hold it up, please.
Thank you. Resolution number 136, a resolution to authorize the county assessor and/or the county treasurer and the receiver of taxes of the town of Oyster Bay to correct erroneous assessments and taxes in accordance with petitions of the county assessor on specific properties situated in various school districts, assess the design owners appearing on the assessment rolls for the specific schools and/or county years pursuant to this resolution. Pursuant to the real property tax law, the county government law of Nassau County, and the county administrative code 278-16.
So moved. Moved by legislator Walker, second by legislator Schaefer. Now, again, I'm asking for an amendment in the nature of a substitution for this item. Motion, please.
So moved.
Moved by legislator Ford, second by legislator Nicolau. And the amendment in the nature of a substitution reads as follows. This amendment changes the resolution by correcting the title and language in the resolved clause from the town of Oyster Bay to the city of Long Beach. This amendment also removes petition number 53-2016 from the resolution. All right, now, all those in favor of the amendment? Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, the amendment passes unanimously. Now for the item as amended, that's item 88, resolution 136. All those in favor of the item as amended, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, the item passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Moving quickly. Next item is item, 78, resolution 162, a resolution authorizing the standardization pursuant to general municipal law section 1035 of side being demodification equipment for the Bay Park sewage treatment plant. I'm going to call item 80 as well, which is resolution 164. A resolution authorizing the standardization pursuant to general municipal law 1035 of engine cooling loop heat exchanges for Bay Park sewage treatment plant 292. Moved by legislator Capel, second by legislator. Is he here to speak on these two items?
Hi, good afternoon. Joe Davenport, Nassau County Department of Public Works. The first item, item 78, I guess it was, the demodification process for the Bay Park Sewage Treatment Plant. Department, we have several projects in planning for reducing nitrogen in the effluent of the Bay Park plant. One of those projects being the demodification process. It's a relatively new process. Been in use for approximately 10 years, primarily in Europe, just recently coming to prominence here in the U.S. What makes this process unique is you're not treating the entire plant flow, you're treating what's called a side stream process, the centrate off of the sludge dewatering process. It's a very high concentration of ammonia which contains nitrogen. So it's an efficient and a less costly way to reduce the nitrogen discharge from the plant, treating this smaller process flow, approximately 5 million gallons per day, as compared to treating the entire plant flow of 50 million gallons per day. The relatively new process, there are limited manufacturers, there are four prime manufacturers for this process. Each of them have very different types of equipment for achieving reduction of the ammonia concentration. Different footprint, different building size. Some require heat exchangers heating the process. Some require fine screens or filters before the process. Some of the manufacturers require a media in the tank for the bacteria to grow on. Because of this, it would be very expensive, virtually difficult to design a contract that could incorporate, you know, all of these processes at the time of bid. The department undertook a pre-selection process to evaluate these four different types of processes, considering their capital cost, the annual operation and maintenance cost, their reliability, robustness, being able to recover from a process upset. And based upon this evaluation process, we're recommending the pre-selection or standardization on the deammonification equipment manufactured by World Water Works.
Any questions of Mr. Davenport on this item? We learned something today.
I do.
Tell them, legislator Dunn.
That helps the maintain oxygen at a better level, so the fish and the wildlife and the water will be able to live.
Correct. It reduces the nitrogen discharge in Reynolds Channel, and yes, ultimately, you know, that nitrogen creates, you know, food for other organisms to grow. They die, they decay, and that takes up the oxygen in that waterway. So yes, reducing that food source for those other organisms helps improve the quality of the Western Bays.
That's excellent. Thank you.
Legislator Rhodes, you have any comment?
Legislator Dunn actually asked my question.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any other comments from the legislators? Any public comment? All right. Why don't we speak? Who has Laura? Legislator Carr.
Thank you. Am I correct in that this item was presented to the legislature back in April?
No, it was not.
Oh, okay. Maybe I'm misunderstanding. Thank you.
Okay,
Legislator Curran?
Yes.
Okay. I'm going to move on to item 80, and then there will be other comments as well.
Okay. Item 80, a little bit different than the previous item. This item asks for standardization of equipment that already exists at the Bay Park plant. Bay Park plant, we generate our own power for running the facility. We use digester gas or natural gas to generate electricity. Part of that engine generation process, there is cooling equipment. Just like you have a radiator in your car, we have heat exchangers to help cool the engines. We have two existing heat exchangers for the engines themselves, two existing heat exchangers on the turbochargers. As we improve the plant processes, increase the equipment on the plant site, the plant has a greater demand for power. So where now we normally operate two engines, we see in the coming future we're going to need to operate three engines at one time. Requires additional cooling capacity to operate those engines. So we're looking to expand the number of heat exchangers for the engines and the turbochargers. We want to match the existing equipment, making sure they operate reliably, operate together as a system, that the existing staff is trained on the maintenance of that equipment. It helps reduce our costs for stocking spare parts. And you know, that would be the reason for the standardization on those heat exchangers.
Any questions or comments from the legislators? Legislator Salatis.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Good afternoon. Once we do buy this, how much will this cost us?
For the heat exchangers, the engine heat exchanger is approximately $50,000. The turbocharger heat exchanger is probably approximately $80,000. But they're just two pieces of equipment in a larger bid contract. I mean, something to note, we are publicly bidding the work. We just want to specify this particular equipment. So together, they're about $130,000 in a $2.6 million construction contract. So I guess they're about 5% of the construction contract value.
Legislator Capel.
Mr. Davenport, I don't have any questions, but for the first time, it's my pleasure actually to compliment a presenter on a extremely lucid and comprehensive explanation of the item, leaving very little question. It's unfortunate that we don't have an awful lot more presentations made in the same way as yours just now.
Okay, thank you very much.
You know, he's worthy of the praise. I know Mr. Davenport many, many years.
And we're honored, absolutely.
Yes, and absolutely. So I think that would be ditto from all of us.
I do want to commend everybody from DPW who's been working at the Bay Park Sewage Treatment Plant, all of you. And I know that, as Legislator Capel said, your explanation as this new type of equipment will be very key and up with the upgrade of that plant. But I have to say, overall, like, knowing from when I first got into office to now, what a difference it has been in every single one of you. Like, really, I tip my hat to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll pass that on.
Okay, Menard and Lena, come on.
How are you, Joe? You alluded to it really quickly, I believe, when Legislator Szilagyi started to ask in regards to the cost. And then you mentioned that this project is, this equipment is part of a larger project, which I guess the larger project has been publicly bidded for, but we wanted to hone in on this piece of equipment. Just elaborate on that a little bit.
Yeah, that's correct. We haven't publicly bid anything yet, but within those design documents, we want to specifically specify certain equipment. The heat exchangers for the engines. There's other work that goes along with the installation of those heat exchangers, improving those systems. As I mentioned, the engineer's estimate, the estimated cost of the bid contract is approximately $2.6 million, and this particular equipment that we're asking your approval to be able to specify, not accept and equal to, is approximately $130,000 of that $2.6
million. So just walk me through the how this vendor was selected.
For the heat exchanger equipment?
Both.
For the heat exchanger equipment, it was a fairly simple selection. It's existing equipment that's on site. We have two heat exchangers in operation right now as part of the engine generator system. We want to add a third. We want the system to work together. We would like to have the same equipment. Again, as I mentioned, the staff is trained on the maintenance and the operation of that equipment. We can maintain the spare parts for just a single type of equipment rather than multiple types of heat exchangers.
So I understand you're using the same vendor that's on the other heat exchangers equipment. So you feel confident that no one else can get that type of equipment or build that type of equipment?
No, we have done an evaluation of equipment that's available, and there are other heat exchangers, but each manufacturer's are a little bit different. And if maybe you were starting with a clean slate, you could say, okay, well, we'll specify we need three heat exchangers, this is the performance requirement, and we'll see, you know, what manufacturers are out there. But we've got existing equipment, and again, it's very important that it works together, it works in tandem. You know, our biggest issue right after Sandy was losing that power generation facility, not being able to pump wastewater for 2.5 days. We can't have those engines go down on us. We need to make sure they operate reliably.
So, well, I would love to see that evaluation because I don't know if that's part of the backup, but also, how do you ensure that the $130,000 that the county is spending, that the price hasn't escalated, that we're not paying more than what this equipment will be valued at?
We actually, so that all the bidders are on equal footing, we get the quote from the vendor, and we include that in the bid documents along with a copy of the resolution that hopefully will be passed today, so that there is a line item in the bid form for the heat exchangers, probably two lines, one for the generator heat exchanger at $50,000, one for the turbocharger heat exchanger at $80,000, and every bidder includes that same cost in their bids.
For the 2.6.
Right,
for the 2.6.
2.6. There's a lump sum bid amount that each bidder is free to develop their own cost estimate for all the work that goes on around them. But for these two items, we want these two pieces of equipment, and everyone's going to include the same amount in their bid for that equipment.
Because there wasn't any bid documents attached to the backup for these two items.
No, we don't want to go through the expense of developing bid documents that includes this equipment if this doesn't pass.
I see what you mean.
I know this is in advance of putting out the bid documents for the project. We will come back here once we do develop the bid documents and we publicly bid them, and we'll come back here like we normally do with a construction contract recommending award to a certain construction contractor.
So the contract may not be, from what I understand from looking through the backup, well, two different items, but I see the contract is to be executed with Addison Global Technology Corporation.
There's not a contract to be executed with them. They would be the specified manufacturer that would go into the construction contract.
Would everybody have to use this particular?
Everybody would use that particular vendor, include that same price in their bid. The successful contractor would then execute a contract with that manufacturer, subcontract with that manufacturer for that equipment.
Okay. And I guess that comes back to my original point, which I believe you explained, but if you could say it again for the record. So, since everybody has to use Addison Global Technology Corporation, you feel that the county has done its due diligence in selecting Addison to provide this level of equipment better than anyone else?
That they are the one manufacturer that can provide the same equipment as we have on site.
So is it sole source? To say they're only one?
We are standardizing on this equipment. For this contract to expand upon the existing system, we would like the same equipment.
Sorry, Madam President, nothing further. Thank you, Ms. Davenport.
Any other questions or comments from the legislators? Any public comment? There being none, all those in favor of item, let me get back to this, please. Items 78 and 80, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Yeah.
What do we have? How many?
Yeses.
Six nays?
Three yeses.
Three nays, so that's three, and 12 is, so it's 15 to three. Okay, the item passes by 15 to three. Okay. Okay. Thank you again, Mr. Davenport. Item is item 60, resolution 144, resolution authorizing the county executive to execute an intermunicipal agreement with the, excuse me, the Massapequa Public Schools in relation to a project to procure and install sports lighting at Fernup Middle School. A motion, please, said Legislator Kennedy. Okay. Moved by Legislator Kennedy, second by. I don't know if it's accepted. Legislator Rose. Any questions or comments regarding this item? Item 60, resolution 144. Who's here to talk about this one? Anybody? No? Okay.
I believe this is a CRP for Legislator Kennedy's district.
Yes, it is.
Correct?
Yes.
Did you want to just expand on the program? Sure.
Would you like to expand on it? Is there a question on it? Yes, who has a question? Who has it?
Is there a question?
Who has a question? Anybody?
Questions?
There are no questions that we can have. I don't know. Do you have a question? Let's go.
Hold on.
Thank you. Minard Alita, do we have a comment, a question, or what?
Yes.
Questions? Okay, thank you very much. There being no questions or comments, all those in favor of item 60, resolution 144, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any opposed? Huh? No? Yes? Okay, we are 18-2.
Okay.
Zero. Nine. Where? The next items to be called pertain to bond ordinances regarding the Nassau Community College, and I believe we go from, I believe, 2, 3, 4, 5, I'm going to read each of them, 6, 7, I will read each of them, and then 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12, beginning with 2, which is ordinance 104. It's a bond ordinance providing for a capital expenditure within the county of Nassau and authorizing 1.2 million of bonds of the county of Nassau to finance such expenditure pursuant to the local finance law of New York and the county of the county governmental law of Nassau County. Right, that's item 2, ordinance 144. Item 3. Item 3 is ordinance 105, another bond ordinance authorizing a capital expenditure of 1.5 million of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure pursuant to the local finance law of New York and the county governmental law of Nassau County. Item 4 is ordinance 106, another bond ordinance requiring identifying within the County of Nassau and authorizing $750,000 of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure pursuant to the local finance law of New York and the county governmental law of Nassau County. Item 5, ordinance 107, another bond ordinance authorizing a capital expenditure of $1.1 million of bonds of the county of Nassau to finance such expenditure pursuant to the local finance law of New York and the county governmental law of Nassau County. Item 6, ordinance 108, a bond ordinance authorizing an expenditure of $240,050 of bonds of the county of Nassau to finance such expenditure pursuant to the local finance law of New York and the county governmental law of Nassau County. Item 7, ordinance 109, another bond ordinance authorizing 2.2 $2,031,990 of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure pursuant to the local finance law of New York and the county governmental law of Nassau County. A is ordinance 110, another bond ordinance authorizing expenditure of $4 million in bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure pursuant to the local finance law of New York and the county governmental law of Nassau County. Item 9 is ordinance 111, another bond ordinance authorizing $1 million in bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure pursuant to the local finance law of New York and the county governmental law of Nassau County. Item 10, ordinance 112, a bond ordinance authorizing $3 million of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure pursuant to the local finance law of New York and the county governmental law of Nassau County. Item 11 is ordinance 113, bond ordinance authorizing $612,000 of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure pursuant to the local finance law of New York and the county governmental law of Nassau County. And item 12, ordinance 114, a bond ordinance authorizing $636,000 of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure pursuant to the local finance law of New York and the county governmental law of Nassau County. Motion for these items. Moved by legislator Dunn, second by legislator, who was that? Moved by legislator Rhodes. All right, okay. Now we can discuss each of these. I think that, who do we have here now to address these items? I see Mr. Pasquarello is here. Okay, we'll begin with item 2, the 104, the expenditure of $2 million of bonds. Go ahead and tell us what that one's for.
But the first, one by one?
Yeah, go ahead.
Anyone to record, please?
This is Vice President Joe Mosprella from Nassau Community College.
Okay.
The first one is for Americans with Disability Act compliance. We'd have to do with upgrading handicap ramps, facilities, et cetera, throughout the college.
Sorry, you can move on to item 3, which is the $1,500,000.
Okay, that's for academic department renovations. I believe there was a handout that was given to each of the members of the legislature before the committee meetings a couple of weeks ago, where we showed some photographs of the various infrastructure issues that would be addressed by each one of these bond items.
Okay. You're probably going to get questions on each of them, but item 4, which is the $750,000.
Yes, that's for building systems improvements, electrical, HVAC, mechanical components of buildings.
And 5?
Five is for infrastructure repair, concrete, road surfaces, sidewalks, some structural components as well.
Item 6 is
2.6. 6 is for replacement of aging windows throughout the campus, particularly in the 1930s vintage buildings that we have. Most of them still have original windows that we've been replacing.
And 7?
7 is for improvements to our parking facilities and roads throughout the campus. Specifically, the next major project is the south parking lot area.
Writing it down, that's must go out.
Okay. 8? And 8 is actually both of those projects. That are item 7 and item 8 have to do with improvements to parking and roads on the campus.
Okay. Go to 9.
9 is for energy initiatives, things like energy efficiency projects, improvements, replacing old equipment with new.
10.
10, both 10 and 11 are our space consolidation program, where we're bringing multiple units of the campus into one facility that would be improved for their occupancy. And 12 is for health and safety. We have various items like asbestos removal, mold removal, anything else that has to do with a health and safety issue on the campus.
Okay, and I did receive a letter today regarding these items, and it's requested on behalf of the college that we consider the 12 items as part of the legislative calendar, and 11 of them range from total renovation of the south and west parking lots to achieving ADA compliance in various facilities to window, heating, and electrical system replacements in various facilities. These are basic health and safety projects that are not particularly showy, but instead are fundamental to the safe operation of the campus. And this was stated in a letter that I received today. And hopefully, it's important for me to read it into the record. Okay, any questions now? This is your turn, ladies and gentlemen of the legislature. Any questions that we'd like to ask?
Yes.
Minority Leader?
I don't have any questions for Mr. Muscarella. I think I saw your backup information that you sent a couple of weeks ago in regards to the infrastructure. I think the projects are well attended. And from that standpoint, definitely are capital and oriented. So I don't have a question for Mr. Muscarella. My questions are really tied to, I guess there would be, there was a report that I had Mr. Chalmers put together from Legislative Budget Review that I wanted to ask that question to him, and then I just wanted to pose another question to the other college representative, Mrs. Kate Murray.
Yes, I am. Mr. Chalmers, would you please, I know that you were asked certain questions from the minority as well as the majority, and hopefully you have the answers to those questions, and some of them put my
Absolutely. Moe Chalmers, Budget Review. I was asked a couple of questions, which I provided the answers to.
Thank you. First, Maurice, I want to thank you for doing this so promptly and quickly. I know I might have reached out to you Thursday evening, and here it is. You're able to put this together on Monday. I have a couple of concerns or questions regarding your report. And it looks like you reached out to Bond Council and DPW in regards to the college. In regards to completing your report. One of the things that it mentions in your report, which I wasn't too sure of, and I'll just quote it, and you correct me if I'm wrong, but based on your conversations with DPW in the first section of the letter or the memo, it says, I guess she's responding to the ability to shift around money from the bond proceeds. Or he's responding, I guess, he or she. Technically, these bonds are purpose PPU bonds, and the funds could be shifted, but the county's policy is not to reprogram identified purposes unless a project is complete or canceled or extraordinary circumstances warrant. I was always under the impression whatever we bonded for had to be utilized for that purpose, and there wasn't any extraordinary circumstances that can change that. What did the person you spoke to mean that?
Yes, absolutely. I believe what he meant by that is up to like a couple of years ago, the county shifted from bonding for project specific to PPUs. So you have the ability to shift from some project that have similar PPUs. That's what he meant by that.
So say for example, if there is parking lot improvements at the college, it could shift to parking lot improvements somewhere else in the county.
No, I don't believe that to be the case.
So give me the example of what he meant by shift to similar PPUs.
Well, we talk about similar PPUs within the college. The money's borrowed for the college, so it would have to be a project with a similar PPU within the college. So I don't believe, and we could ask DPW to clarify that statement, but I don't believe you could take money that was borrowed for the college and use it for a Nassau County parking lot.
So this money has to be used on the college?
That's correct. And if you read on, I think if you go further down, he explains also the limitations and also the matches that need to happen in order for this money to be used.
Maurice, have you had a chance to read through the bond ordinance?
No, I have not read to all of them, to most of them.
Because council advises us that the bond ordinance does not indicate that.
You know, when you reached out to me on Thursday and understanding the urgency of getting these items on,
I appreciate it.
And there's one follow-up after the other, I would probably advise that we get bond council in the room with your council and the college and get all those questions answered. If we don't do that, we'll be going one answer and then we get an answer to that and another question and another follow-up.
I would love to have that, and that's why I wanted to bring up Ms. Kate Murray to the podium, because
I'm sure she would agree to that too.
I respectfully requested that we don't call this today, not because we don't want to see it go forward. I think everyone on our side want to see it go forward, but we want to make sure that the intention is going towards the college, and with the lack of clarity, it just seems like I would love to have to be able to do this on the 19th once bond council sits down with yourself and the college, our council, majority's council, and be able to move forward.
I think it's always a good thing to get everybody in the room and not shoot off one question after the other and try to get an answer. If everybody gets in the room, we could iron out all the details, get all the answers, and possibly decide, make a decision.
Well, let me ask, if I may, Kate, if you don't mind.
Yes, good afternoon.
Hi,
for
how
the
are
record.
You?
I'm Kate Murray, Assistant to the President of Nassau Community College for Governmental Affairs and Media Relations.
That's a long title.
It sure is, I can say.
Kate, I think I speak for our side that we believe that the project, and you and I have spoken, we believe that these projects are well-intended, and we have always supported the college, and we want to continue to show our support of the college. And I would love to be able to get our counsel with bond counsel, Mr. Chalmers, yourself, or whoever the college deems, the majority counsel in the room, so we can be able to vote on this with confidence to make sure that the college is getting every nickel of this and it's being done in a very, very, very above board manner. If we were able to entertain this on October 19th, which is our next legislative meeting, would that present any jeopardy to the college in regards to not being able to have these proceeds in place?
Well, Mr. Minority Leader, I thank you for your support and for the support of all of the 19 legislators. Judy Jacobs was a great friend to the college, as we know. And we are very, very grateful indeed for your continuing support. With regard to October 19th, we are ready, willing, and able to come back to answer any questions that you may have about the specific bonding requests, the projects underlying them. Any information that you need, we'd be delighted to share with you. With regard to whether October 19th poses a timeline scenario for the Nassau Community College, we are okay with that. With that, I do have to do a little commercial for Nassau Community College. Of course, SUNY directs those matching funds, and it is a finite pot of dollars. And so, of course, once we get the bonding authorization from all of you, and we certainly are looking forward to, we hope, a unanimous decision, we then present that to SUNY. Every single day that goes past, there is an opportunity for another community college in New York State to try to grab those dollars. That being said, if we can get to a point where October 19th, all 18 legislators are on board, we would be delighted at that day.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that.
I'm going to do everyone a big favor. And that we're going to table these items, okay? And guess what? We have a meeting on October 5th. This meeting will be recessed. And I believe between now and October 5th, we should be able to come up with the answers to the questions that were raised. So rather than waiting to October 19th, I think we can do it sooner than later.
Well, that would be absolutely delightful.
Okay, so I'm moving to table this item.
If I may, Madam Design Officer, I think Mrs. Murray and I, we discussed that. I didn't envision Mr. Chalmers' report taking that long.
Well, what do you want? Right?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying is it wouldn't take that long to the 19th. And I believe in our discussions,
If you were to deem a full legislative meeting or call this one to recess the 5th, doesn't present a problem. That being said, that's why I thought it'd be better and more prudent, because everybody wants to vote for the college, and everybody, their supporters, if I may, finish, please.
Go ahead, finish.
I think everyone agrees that they would like to see this unanimously because of what the college is currently enduring. We don't want to show any slight that the college does not have unanimous support in this legislature. And just so we could get the answers, I think, you know, being able to carry it forward for another 2 weeks would do that.
Okay, let me also say something and address the point made by Ms. Murray. And that is, we do run the risk of other SUNY institutions of receiving some of this funding. And I don't want to do that. And if we can do it, Mr. Chalmers, can we do it by the 5th? Now I'm giving you more than a week. I'm giving you 8 days.
That should be fine.
Thank you very much. And so I'm tabling this, and I need a second to the table. Okay, all those in favor of tabling it, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All these items are tabled, and we will come back in about 8 days. And you got your work cut out for you, Mr. Chalmers.
Thank you, as always, on behalf of Nassau Community College, to all of our legislators for your support.
All right, thank you. I have another number of items that we're going to call a block. Of course, we'll address them separately, but I will call them on the record so that we can move as quickly as possible, considering what we're going to be up against at the end of our meetings today. And I'm going to begin with item 15, ordinance 117. Bond ordinance calling for a capital expenditure of $750,000 bonds. Item 16, ordinance 118, another bond ordinance calling for an expenditure authorizing $500,000 of bonds. Item 17, ordinance 119, a bond ordinance authorizing a sum up to $2,623,000 of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. 18, ordinance 120, another bond ordinance to authorize $2,200,000 of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 19, ordinance 121, a bond ordinance authorizing $1 million of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 20, ordinance 122, a bond ordinance authorizing $1 million of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 22, ordinance 124, bond ordinance authorizing $1,509,000 in bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 24, ordinance 126, a bond ordinance authorizing $120,809 in bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. And hold on, there's more to come. Item 28, ordinance 130, a bond ordinance authorizing $500,000 of bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 29, ordinance 131, another bond ordinance authorizing $750,000 of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 30, ordinance 132, a bond ordinance authorizing $750,000 of bonds for the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 31, ordinance 133, a bond ordinance authorizing $2,400,000 of bonds for the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 32, ordinance 134, bond ordinance authorizing $1,500,000 of bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure, and I believe, no, we got item 36, ordinance 138, bond ordinance authorizing $500,000 of bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. And we have item 39, ordinance 141, bond ordinance authorizing $500,000 of bonds of the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Motion, please, for all those items, approved by Legislative Dunn, second by Legislative Hill. All right, now, Mr. Arnold, I don't know what you're going to do, but do the best you can trying to address each of them and as succinctly as possible. And,
okay, next batch. Ken Arnold, Public Works. The first item, 117, is for Austin Boulevard. That is a ongoing design project. This money is to cover the contingency of the design contract, the labor for the department and program management funding that we require. The following item, item 16, is Old Country Road Phase 1. That contract is currently in construction. This funding is our contingency and labor for our engineers who oversee the project. Item 17, Traffic Communication Phase 2, that is the ongoing design project. This is construction money. We'll be looking to get concurrence with the state for building this project in 2017 and require funding to be ready for that. Item 18 is Traffic Signal Expansion Phase 5. This is Middle Neck Road and Lakeville Road. This contract has already been bid. We are waiting to issue a notice of award to the contractor. We require the bond ordinance for the county's portion of funding. Item 19, Traffic Signal Expansion Phase 6 is Roslyn Road, Main Street, Old Golden Boulevard, Bryant, and West Shore Road, all up in the Port Washington area, Roslyn area. Again, this contract was bid. We are waiting to issue notice of award for the contract to begin work. Require the bond ordinance to secure the funding. Item 20 is Traffic Signal Expansion Phase 3, North Main Street in Freeport. This project design is substantially complete. This is the construction funding, and this job will go out to bid in late 16. Item 21, Boulder Complete Streets Project. Okay. 22 call? Yes. Item 22 is bridge painting contract. This contract was also a bid. We're waiting to issue notice of award for the contract to require the funding to move forward. Which, excuse me? 24 is next. Item 24 is the 5 towns drainage analysis. This is the county funding to go with the analysis that's being done by GOSAR. There's components of the project that are outside the scope of GOSAR, but are integral to be looked at in totality for the 5 towns area. This is the county portion of that funding.
28
is next. Requirements contract for roads, drainage, and bridges. This item, I believe, is to cover the county's labor for in-house personnel working on these types of items in the department. It's important for us on our operational budget to get the capital backcharge secured so we can backcharge our employees properly. 29 was next?
Yes, 29.
29 is similar, is that it's to cover county labor associated with traffic studies. We have a tremendous backlog of traffic studies. Our employees are working on that. We require the adequate funding so we can backcharge our work. Item 30.
30.
Again, is a similar situation for pavement markings. We have our sign shop that puts down pavement markings and our engineers who study and design the pavement markings. Again, this would be a county labor. 31 is a capital project associated with handicap access ramps on county roads, also on our audible pedestrian signals on county roads. The county has a lot of in-house work to meet a judge's order for the proper passage for a complete streets project for any intersection that we redesign or reconstruct, and this would cover that work. 32, the next one?
Yes.
The next, that 32 is associated with, just double check my notes. 69. Excuse me one second.
Okay.
That is for county labor associated with traffic signal construction modifications. This allows the department to continue designing signals using in-house forces and also overseeing the inspection of anything that's ongoing currently. Again, it's important for our county labor backcharge. 36. 36 is traffic signs. Again, our sign shop puts up traffic signs, modifies traffic signs, installs new traffic signs. This is the labor associated with that, also for engineering.
And
37 is the next one?
39
is, again, this was for pavement markings. This is for the construction contract. The county is currently waiting to issue notice of award for our phase 8 project for pavement markings throughout the county for long lines. This is a state reimbursed project.
Okay, now time for questions. I just want to sum up something. I would say that most of these have to do with our public safety.
Yes.
Okay. Go ahead, and I'll.
Public safety in regards to the roads?
Correct.
Oh, okay. Well, not public safety as we deem it, the legislature considered and passed unanimously, the ambulances and the police vests. Well,
public safety considering the roads, so the roads are safe for the traveling public.
Of course, we always want that.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
No public comment? Okay, there being none, all those in favor of the items that were called, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Okay. So we have the items passed 12. They failed. Failed 12 to 6. Correction. Items failed 12 to 6. These are all bond ordinances requiring a 13. Okay, now we're going to go back. Yes. Here we go again. I'm going to call a number of the items in block, and then we'll, of course, talk about each of them separately. And I'm beginning with item 13, ordinance 115, the bond ordinance authorizing $100,000 of bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 14, ordinance 116, a bond ordinance authorizing $1,200,000 of bonds for the Nassau County to finance such expenditure. Item 23, ordinance 125, the bond ordinance authorizing $10,600,000 of bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 25, ordinance 127, bond ordinance authorizing $722,572 of bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. 27, ordinance 129, a bond ordinance authorizing $100,000 of bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 33, ordinance 135, bond ordinance authorizing $1,000,000 of bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 35, bond ordinance authorizing $1,000,000 of bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 37, ordinance 139, bond ordinance authorizing $1,000,000 of bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Item 38, bond ordinance 140 to authorize $315,500 of bonds to the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Okay, a motion, please. Moved by legislator Dunn, seconded by legislator McKenzie. Okay, now, who's going to speak on these? I think you're ready, yes, Mr. Arnold. You can take it one at a time, and I'll tell you which ones to go. All right, we'll begin with 13, item 13, ordinance 115.
Item 13, Ken Arnold, Public Works. Item 13 is for the FireCom radio systems for additional work that's required on that project. Item 14 is for the fire communication computer-aided dispatch system for additional services associated with that program.
Okay, hold on.
Item 23 is next.
You got it.
Item 23 is for the county storage tank program. The county's under an order of consent, and this is construction of money that for projects that are being designed currently, and we hope to be ready for construction in January. This is for, again, for a consent order for the county.
Item
25. 25 is for the county's asbestos projects. The county's department does work in various county buildings. We run across asbestos. This money is used to bring in our specialized contractors to both study and evaluate the asbestos and also to remove it.
Item 27.
Item 27 is for the disparity study. The department's looking at its MWB and DBE goals and is looking to do some work on the disparity study to see what needs to be updated.
Okay, item 33.
Item 33 is for e-government. This is for the IT department. This is for the in-house labor of the people working on the various programs and keeping our infrastructure, our systems up and running on the Capitol end.
And now 35.
35 is for infrastructure. This is for labor to do the maintenance, not the maintenance, I'm sorry, I misspoke, but on the capital improvements that are required for the various computer hardware that the county has.
37.
This is again from the fuel tank program. This is for the county labor. This is what our engineers utilize for complying with the consent order and all the reports and other types of documents that we're currently going through.
38
is a contract that's currently in design. This is for the viral message systems. This ties to the traffic management center at the debate. You notice today we have these portable DMS signs that are all over, alerting the motorists of what to do, what not to do. This would be permanent structures on our major avenues, Old Country Road, Maricopa Peninsula Boulevard, to assist the motorists in navigating the traffic situations, their feedback straight to our traffic management center. This is a construction contract. This job would be ready to be out to construction sometime in early 17, once we receive state concurrence.
Okay, any comments or questions from the legislators? I just cited them.
That last one, was that for Amber Alerts and all of that?
It could be used for Amber Alerts also.
It could be used for Amber Alerts also, but it's for any type of alert that we put out to the motorists, yes.
All emergency alerts, right?
Yep.
Thank you.
And also for traffic conditions, you know, timing and things like that.
Oh, just. Okay, I think that that's the end of the questions. I honestly think Ms. Arno, since we are under the situation that we are facing at about 5-6 o'clock when we leave here, I think that we're trying to expedite it as quickly as we can. Okay. Now, since
I do have questions with respect to, with respect to items 13 and 14, 343-16 and 344-16. The Firecom radios, where can I go?
Yes.
Yeah, the Firecom radios, are those the multi-band radios so that they can communicate between departments?
I believe so. I'd have to double check with Firecom exactly what that is, but I believe
that's. I think that's exactly what it is. And also, with respect to item 14, the Firecom computer-aided dispatch. Not every department in Nassau County has its own dispatcher, and the computer-aided dispatch would assist Firecom in deploying fire department resources in the event of an alarm.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So can these directly pertain to public safety?
Yes, they do.
I think Legislator Rose brought up a great point. Let's pull out that one item. We'll be happy to support it, and the rest we won't.
Okay,
if they're really for public safety.
I think there's two.
There's two? Even better. If they're 13. Really public safety, let's pull them out, because we're
13?
Committed to doing public safety.
Is it 13 too?
So we can do that in the rush.
13 and 14, yes.
13 and 14?
Is that okay with you, Mr. Legislator Rose?
Yeah, why not? Yeah.
Let me pull out the rest.
Okay. All right. Now let's do this. All right, we'll vote on 13 and 14 first, correct? All right, so that we don't get confused here. So all those in favor of item 13 and item 14 signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so that's unanimous. All right. Now the other ones, and I will call them, because we may have forgotten which items they were. Item 23, ordinance 125, item 25, ordinance 127, item 27, ordinance 129, item 33, ordinance 135, item 35, ordinance 137, item 37, ordinance 139, item 38, ordinance 140, and I believe that's it. Okay. All right, all those in favor, those items that I just called, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Nay.
Okay, the items fail 12-6. Yes, sir.
I don't know, we've been jumping around, so I just want to make sure.
What?
Is the legislature taking action on item 21?
Wait a minute. I don't.
Before we recess, I know we're going to put this meeting into recess. I just want to.
No. We got more stuff to do.
I didn't say we're doing it.
Not calling 21.
Why is the legislature, or why you have deemed not to call item 21? It passed through committees. Just because. That's good.
Yeah.
People deserve that.
Don't worry about it. There's good reason.
I'm sorry?
it because it was a decision that we had to make. Okay?
I'm not sure if I understand this one.
All right, okay.
What's the, why, give us the reason why item 21 is not. Why the reason, give us the, we just considered, see, now we're going to go into a circus. We just considered, I would say, well over a dozen items. Item 21 passed in the committee. This legislature decided, you, Madam Presiding Officer, decided to place it on the calendar for committee. It passed through committee, and now you have made the decision not to call it. I think the people of this county deserve a response on why you decided not to call it.
Let me say something to you. We just failed to pass a number of bond ordinances that affect every area of the county. And no question was asked of you as to why you thought it was necessary to vote against it. Now, this particular item, like some of the other items, may have had the same kind of objection on the part of the majority, and so therefore, guess what? We decided not to call it.
That doesn't make any sense, Madam President.
Nothing makes sense. You have known
our objection on the capital plan project, not because of the project. I think Mr. Arnold does a very good job of presenting them. That's not the issue. You've known our objections because the lack of transparency and procurement is handled in this county. So let's not mix things together. The second thing is, this project was good enough to be deemed to be placed on the committee calendar 2 weeks ago. It was also good enough to be placed on the calendar today because it passed in the legislature 2 weeks ago in committee. Now, we decide to go through considering all these other items, but we exclude this one.
Okay.
And there's no political tinge tied to it. The fact that it's a project that is represented by Legislator Curran, who happens to sit on this side of the aisle. And there's no political tinge tied to it, I'm guessing. None.
No.
You're going to say that on the record? None.
We have the discretion.
Impressive. Impressive.
And there were many items that you failed to do.
Madam Presiding Officer, I understand we have taken the position that we would only consider to bond for items that are public safety in nature, but you don't know how we're going to vote on this particular item. You have no idea how Legislator Curran could vote on this item. You basically have dangled this item in front of us in hopes that we would probably support the other items. That's what you're doing. But you don't want to own up to that, but let's just be honest, what we're saying to the people, that we're not going to consider this item because the folks in the minority, legislative minority, have decided to vote against the other bonding items because there's no procurement or transparency in this process. That sounds great to the Nassau County people. I look forward to mentioning
that. That's your opinion.
Thank you. No, that's not my opinion. That's my fact. Because you can't give me a logical reason on why you didn't call it. Why don't you call it?
I can give it plenty of logical reasons.
Yes, I would love to hear.
Why isn't it that all those bond ordinances that we just passed, that just failed, not one of you was good enough to say, okay, it has to do with...
What does that have to do with this item?
You're required to give a proper response
to the people on why you're not calling item. I would understand if the item never saw the light of day, like a lot of stuff in this place, and it sits in the clerk's office. But this item you put on the committee calendar. This item passed through the Finance and Rules Committee, and for some reason you made the unilateral decision to not call it today. After calling all these other bond items.
It happens all the time.
I think one of the things we have problems we have on this side is we're confused as to what your position is because you apparently tried to carve out a position in terms of public safety items. So we can expect that if it's not a public safety item, you're going to vote against it. Now you want us to call this one because the reasons we don't know, whereas you just voted against a whole bunch of items.
Rich, let's be fair. You didn't know. We just set that position in regards to the public safety. Legislator Rose brought out those FireCom issues. We decided to vote for them. But the other items, you called those.
Well, I mean, what's...
Why don't you call all of them?
Let's know.
It just seems a bit weird.
Tell us what your position is. Doesn't it seem a bit weird
of all the bonding items today, the one item you don't call is a bond ordinance for Baldwin Complete Streets. Doesn't that seem a little weird?
I understand the point you're making, but again,
you told us
that you're going to vote for public safety items. You're not going to vote for other items because of objections with the process.
Okay.
Now you're going to tell us you want to vote on this item, and we don't understand why. What additional area are you calling? What's special about this road,
Kevon? Because when we have other roads that come up for bonding that other people used to support, they vote against it when there's bonding. Then when that's reported, then they vote for a transfer and take credit for it. You're mixing the point.
There's nothing special or not special.
But don't you believe
that every single item should be called?
There was no problem with the underlying purchase of the firecom items. Do you want to call the items? It's about the procurement, right? Do you want to call the items first?
Yes or no?
No.
Okay. We don't want to call all the items. We're only going to call the ones that favor our side.
The same process was followed for all the other items, okay? And you voted them down. Now you're going to tell me that there's a difference in 21, right? And that the process is not transparent and that we didn't follow the... I am sorry. In either for these public safety programs or not, all right? And either they all satisfy the transparency and the procurement that you're looking for. Let's just call it what it is.
You guys want to put us on record for voting against these bond items. I get that. So trust me, I get that. I really do. Then I would say you would continue that mantra and allow this item to be called. Why did you exclude this item? I can't get a rationale. It seems like a horse and carrot type of thing, that if we were supporting the other stuff, we'll consider this one too. I guess that's why it wasn't called at all, or it was going to be called after these projects were to be called.
Call it a block.
Why did you call it a block? I don't understand why we're calling anything in a block. You didn't call it a block before. I mean, it just seems to me astonishing that you guys can't even mask.
Just tell us what other items you're going to vote for when the wall called. I mean, you're going to say the process doesn't apply to this one because let's consider.
How many bond items? 38 today?
Well, we didn't do it. They failed.
30, but we considered 38, but we left off the 39. Why did we leave off the 39th? I would love to hear an explanation. Why didn't you include it in the vote that you did?
Okay, give us an explanation as to what additional areas you're carving out besides public safety, because apparently you want this item called.
Rich, I would love to hear your explanation.
I'm waiting for yours.
When you went into the rationale of excluding it before I brought it up just now. I would love to hear your explanation
as to what additional areas you're going to vote for. This way we'll put those areas on and we can vote for
them. Well, you know what? When you share your position on why what the county has done to make our procurement process more transparent and more thorough, we will be happy to tell you it's far from that.
I didn't want to say it to you. Okay, let me say something to you. There are a lot of bond ordinances that were worthy of everyone's approval, but you chose not to do it for your own reasons. I'm telling you right now, I'm not sure that if I put this forward today, you hear me? That we would get the kind of vote you want.
But Norma, you weren't sure about the other 38 items.
Oh yes, that's the point.
You weren't sure about those either, but you chose to leave, put those on, and take the one that you decided.
Let's call it for what it is. Hey, can we at least be the
18 of us, God bless, Judy Jacobs.
Did you hear me?
Let's just call it what it is. I mean, let's just call it what it is, all right? We know what it is. It was a character.
Let's go, we're done. All right? We got two more items and let's see where we're going.
Okay. This one is
another one. Item 26, ordinance 128. It's a bond ordinance authorizing $1 million in bonds for the County of Nassau to finance such expenditure. However, I need a motion to put it on the table. Motion, please. All right. Seconded by, moved by Legislator Nicola, and seconded by Legislator Dunn. However, I need to amend this item. I'm so offering an amendment in the nature of substitution. All those, a motion to amend the item in the nature of substitution, moved by Legislator Dunn. I'll give you what the item is. And seconded by Legislator Nicola. The amendment removes supplemental staffing and personal service agreements from Section 1 of the ordinance and from the staff summary. The bond amount has been changed from $1 million to $2 million. That's the amendment to the nature of substitution.
And the calendar says
$1 million. All right. The calendar itself says $1 million, however, it should have said $2 million. So all those in favor of the amendment to the nature of the substitution signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. I'm going to assume we have a double C. All right. Now, now for the item 26 as amended. All right. Any questions or comments regarding that? 26. It was amended because the amount was wrong in the calendar. It should have read $2 million instead of read $1 million. All right, and so any questions or comments regarding this item? All right, there being none, all those in favor of item 26 as amended signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Nay.
All right, the item fails 12-6. Now we have one more item, which is 34, bond ordinance 136, authorizing $1,500,000 of bonds of the county of Nassau to finance such expenditure. Motion, please. Moved by Legislator Dunn, seconded by Legislator Schaefer. All right. However, again, I need a motion to amend this item in the nature of a substitution. And the hard to meet it yet. The item, the bond amount has been changed from $1,500,000 to $5 million. The calendar reads wrong. So motion to accept the amendment to the nature of substitution, moved by Legislator Dunn, seconded by Legislator Schaefer. Are all those in favor of the amendment to the nature of substitution signify by saying aye. Any opposed? Okay, now for the item 34, as amended. Any questions or comments regarding item 34? Okay, being none, all those in favor of item 34 as amended, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Nay.
Okay, the item fails 12-6. Okay, I believe that is the end of the regular calendar, correct?
Thank you.
Thank you.